I forgot to add this section, so I'm going to talk about how Blue Team is utilized in this last mission. But I'm also going to add a short explanation of what I do and don't like in general about them, like I did with Osiris. So just like the last mission that Osiris was in, Blue Team isn't really given all that much dialogue. But contrasted to Osiris, all of these characters are already established. Unlike, you know, you have Vale, just brought into this game, Tanaka, also just brought into this game, and you have two established characters. Meanwhile, the rest of Blue Team is established. Kelly is probably the Chief's second closest friend, fast and deadly. Fred, probably the most tactically prepared member of all the Spartan 2s. And Linda is quiet but makes up for it with deadly efficiency behind the scope of a sniper rifle. And also Linda, perhaps while not the closest person to the Chief, is probably the one with the deepest connection to him, since she literally died in his arms during the Battle Above Reach, sorry spoilers, and was brought back to life thanks to Dr. Halsey during the events of First Strike. I'm not going to spoil the plots to either story, as you should definitely read The Fall of Reach and First Strike if you want to understand more about Blue Team and the Spartan 2 program in general, but for a lot of people coming into this game, not having them talk that much and establishing character traits so early at this point in the game wasn't really a bad thing. While not having their reunion on screen is really disappointing, at least seeing them together is a welcome addition to the story. And as they stick with the Chief as he goes AWOL to find Cortana, it helps show how deep their bond really is to each other, and how through hell and high water, they stick together because they're family. My main problem with Blue Team, however, is how they are treated throughout the rest of the main campaign, as they aren't at all set up well as they are in the books. Instead of being well developed on screen, it's not really done that well. Instead of bringing their attributes from the books to the games, they're just there. Nothing really makes them stand out as characters, and even when something interesting happens, it's not necessarily due to them. And it's infuriating to see as someone who has read the books. The storytelling potential that this game has continues to be wasted by the video game equivalent of Brike. And it's just as bad as any of the bullshit decisions made during the entire runtime of The Legend of Korra. Oh, I'm gonna get to that properly one day.
I love being an ODST. It's point and shoot, not this gray area BS.
We come back to Osiris in the next mission. The next cutscene deals with Locke and Buck talking about their newest mission. Buck is extremely dissatisfied with the fact they're going after the Chief, talking about how much he'd love being an ODST compared to being a Spartan working for Oni. Locke seems rather calm, brushing this off that every target is just another target. Buck doesn't really like that answer and asks how they're even supposed to bring Blue Team in, with Locke responding by throwing an armor lock device at Buck, rendering him immobile. After taking off the device, Locke walks away as Buck tells him that the rest of the UNSC, when they find out, Osiris will be hated. Locke responds that he isn't the only one here because of Chief, and the scene fades out again to end. This scene, for short as it is probably the second best cutscene in the entire game. For one, Buck's dialogue is pretty good here. Now Nathan Villian, he has that natural talent of making a bad line seem really well written with his performance, so that's really good, but not only that, he has actual good writing behind his dialogue. It sounds like stuff that ODST Buck would say in this situation. It further shows his experience and how it relates to his character. I wouldn't expect a frontline soldier to just love being in a more restrictive environment, but also lends his experience to how he knows how much Chief is revered, and that going on this mission after him would make them be viewed very negatively by the rest of the UNSC. And while I find Locke's lack of emotion and expression in this scene to be kind of annoying, it at least does show something for his character, and that he only really cares about getting and finishing a job. It helps connect him to his character in his Nightfall, and really shows how much of a cold motherfucker he can be. But once again, I have a big complaint. Just like with the last mission that we were doing with Osiris, why aren't we having them, you know, reacting to the colonies disappearing, and not only that, how are we not having them react to Chief going AWOL? We don't have all of their reactions again. It's just Locke and Buck. This is why I say Locke and Buck are the main guys we should be keeping an eye out on, because they are the backbone of Osiris. They're the ones who actually are talking about this stuff. Just copy my criticism from the first mission on how they weren't really treating the colony disappearances seriously, and paste it here and edit it a bit. Once again, these are the guys we're following for most of the campaign, and we're not going to show in the cutscenes how they all feel about this, Buck is the only one who really gets that kind of treatment, at least in these cutscenes. The rest of them have thoughts in the game itself, but nowhere near as well done as Buck's reaction. He clearly respects the Chief, and since he was saved by one on Reach, if you take into account the Easter egg in New Alexandria, where he helped Buck out as a level 6, he has a great reverence for the Spartan as well, which isn't really typical of ODSTs considering their rivalry in the main canon. But like I said earlier, I will give the scene this. It's still pretty good in my book. But, just like everything else good in the game, it just needs a few tweaks to truly make work. We then transition to Osiris arriving at Meridian, an independent colony that was glassed by the Covenant in 2548. A company is there terraforming the surface to give it an atmosphere Weyland-Yutani style to make it livable. And who do we get this information from? None other than Tanaka? Oh, now we finally get some dialogue out of you. And some actual world-building dialogue too, that's even better. She also explained that it's better to take the elevator down because the independence types don't like the UNSC just waltzing into their territories, seeing it as an act of aggression. I'm getting some weird Firefly vibes from her, just saying. You should have just made her Zoe. Also, shouldn't Buck be saying that if that were the case, if it were a Firefly reference? Whatever. I'll give props for just giving us the bare minimum of insight into Tanaka, though. She obviously hasn't been with the UNSC all that long, considering she survived a planet getting classed towards the end of the war. This is probably what made her join the UNSC, so going into that type of environment is important for her. She knows exactly what to expect from these people, but before we can get more to say, we see the Prometheans are attacking the colony out of nowhere. The entirety of the mission deals with Osiris trying to save the people of Meridian from the Prometheans as they attempt to overwhelm the colony. Why are the Forerunners even here? We'll get to that, I promise. I know it seems like a total coincidence, and it is, but bear with me, this will all make sense in the macro. As Osiris descends the elevator and observes the attack, Governor Sloan of the company Liang Dortmund... Hey! I told you this was a Firefly reference. That's basically the same name of the Alliance vessel and the pilot of Firefly. You know, the one that nearly gets the Serenity on that legal salvage operation, the Dortmunder? That's what it is, the Liang Dortmund. What the fuck, Brian Reed? Stop making references to vastly superior works in your shitty game. He's awfully pissy about the UNSC coming to the planet and is interfering with his affairs, but Locke isn't going to give him help anyway, whether he likes it or not. Throughout the mission, you help drive back the Prometheans from the colony, as Sloan starts to ease back up on the Spartans in terms of raging on them all the time. Once again, nothing much of the story really happens in the mission itself, but for what it's worth, it's probably the most logically consistent level in the whole game. The task is simple, you're given the tools to do it, nothing really stupid happens in terms of the dialogue and the overall execution of the level. Unless you're playing on Legendary, but even then, it's far easier than Halo 2. Far, far easier. Being able to save the civilians is something we haven't done since Reach, and for a story element, shows how Osiris is willing to save those that need help, even if they aren't UNSC. After holding off the Promethean attack, Sloan lets Osiris into Meridian Station and the scene ends, transitioning into the first of three guns down missions. We are almost at the point where the story just fails and completely dies. At this point in the game, we've gotten one mission that didn't require a lot of brain power to understand, and the last two has logic so stupid you'd think you were reading a book written by Jimmy Kimmel. On a first playthrough, you might not see all the flaws laid bare as they are, but I've played this campaign like 10 times, and the flaws just keep getting worse. There's stuff I've noticed I haven't even recognized before I decided to start writing this fucking video. When someone can find more and more flaws in your story the more they look into it, and they are all major flaws or at least a lot of minor ones, you were really in need of a rewrite big time, Brian Reed. How no one in the writer's room looked at this script and thought to themselves, hey, this makes no fucking sense and we need to tweak a lot in order to get what we want out of there, is beyond me. Man, I just wish I was there. I probably could have written a better fucking game, and I haven't even written an actual story before. I've been working my ass off for about 3 weeks so far writing this script, so if Brian Reed can get paid a shit ton of money for this abortion of a story, I'll just sell a better story script to Microsoft for free. Not like they or 343 would listen, but hey, it is what it is.
Station is, as stated earlier, a guns down mission that is more focused on finding secrets and observing the environment rather than fighting enemies. Before you talk to Sloan about the Master Chief and Blue Team, it is revealed that Sloan is actually a smart AI in the late stages of rampancy. He's seen trying to get his people to be calm and not to get in the UNSC's way as they have helped their people and are here for a specific purpose. While the mood from the colonists is hostile towards the Spartans, and they also act somewhat antagonistic towards them, they at least let Osiris do what they need to do. Sloan acts very defensive about discussions for his health, for understandable reasons, and lets Osiris do their investigation, which isn't a very long one. The area you're in is decently sized and offers a lot of room for exploration. While there are audio logs that help flesh out the colony's history, the more important thing for you to do is to listen to the people talking to get the whereabouts of Blue Team. Now, if you're a lazy bastard like me, or you've played this game 1,000 times like me, you'll just find your info really quickly. Though I do remember, if you do listen, you'll hear people talk about other stuff that's going on around them. The first person you go to talk to is a security guard in the building to the left. A scientist is asking him if anyone who was with him at the outpost during the attack. When he heard Meridian Station was being attacked, he got on a mongoose and saw Blue Team's prowler coming in really low. Locke asked if he saw any markings, with the dude being an antagonistic douchebag that would be paced if this were Half-Life 1 or Postal 2, but basically spells out that it was using SC. Then in the next building over, a doctor is talking to a guard that sounds pretty traumatized about the attacks. He heard a faint distress call, but the tower he was in caught fire. He seems to be in pain, but the doctor gives him some painkillers. He then says he heard screams about something coming from the caves, presumably crawlers, then the signal died. Locke offers assistance and asks for their location, only for the dude's tone to switch to total asshole mode again, and says location, Apogee, has good people guarding it and basically telling him to fuck off. Buck rightly assumes that this Apogee is where they need to go, so they find a terminal to get access to it. As they try to get the info they need, Sloan interrupts them. Now, for some fucking reason, the interaction between Locke and Sloan didn't bother to play, but basically what happens is that Sloan is picking at them for messing around with this terminal, which Locke apologizes for, and says they need to go to Apogee in order to find the chief. Sloan gives them a pelican to use, and Osiris boards it and continues their search in the next mission. Wait, that's it? That's all? Man, that was short. Way too short. There isn't really that much to say about Meridian Station. It's just a short little hub section that has you investigating the area trying to find out where Team and Blue Team are. That's all you can really say about it. I do like the environmental details and the logs about the glassing of the planet by the Covenant, but other than that, we don't have much of anything to do here. This needed something like the New Orders Hub, where you can travel around it in a lot of different ways, finding secrets and logs, and, you know, really learning more about the new world that's in and the rise of Nazi Germany, you know, as they've taken over the entire world. And this also shouldn't have been our only stop here. But no, the plot has to progress, guys. We have to get to the Battle of the Century in the next mission. Do you really need any further proof that this game's rushed? It shouldn't take less than 10 minutes to breathe through something like this. Where's the build-up? Where's the tension, the urgency? Key elements continue to be trampled on, and it's really hampering the story. And instead of 3 straight Osiris missions, why not have a chief mission in between Meridian Station and the next one? Showing them landing, fighting the Prometheans, seeing potential messages from Cortana and fighting and boarding the Guardian and Congruous, with Osiris searching for them. This would have been a really good way to help any confusion in the plot and really tie the story together, but because we only get one perspective thus far, everything looks off. But don't worry though, we're almost at the halfway point. Almost. And now it is finally time to hunt the Chief. We drop out of our Pelican to start the level at Apogee and are immediately greeted by a bunch of fucking Prometheans. Sloan also has a security force there to keep an eye on everything, but this isn't like older Halo games where the AI isn't great but was still super handy in certain situations and you come to care to them to the point where you try to keep them alive as much as possible. You can't really do that here. Not only because with the added movement abilities and different ways to attack that you are basically your own big force as a Spartan is, so it's really pointless to really care about characters that aren't as strong as you, since you have 3 other ones, but during the frantic flow of combat, it's barely noticeable when people die. And that really makes this mission worse, because if we're supposed to be helping these people, if you can't make it very noticeable when a bunch of them die, especially if they're right beside you, it really takes away from the tension that the level's supposed to exude. It's not that I would have minded AI companions, but have 3 Spartans, and the normal human AI isn't as good as the Spartans, obviously not as strong or as fast, and going up against the Prometheans, which are more dangerous than the Covenant and also have weapons that can turn them into dust, of course they're going to die faster. Just another letdown in terms of this game trying to make you feel like you're accomplishing something. If anything, it's just hilariously pathetic to hear the colonists go, "We don't need the Spartans to fight our battles," and then get killed almost immediately. Man, I miss the good AI companions that you got in Combat Evolved, Halo 2, Halo 3, even Halo Reach wasn't bad. With that, like, why can't we get good AI companions? Where's Chips Dubow? Where's Sergeant Johnson? Well, he's dead, but what about Stacker? This is literally the only Halo game that doesn't have Sergeant Stacker in it. Why isn't he in this fucking game? Not that Osiris isn't bad, but playing on harder difficulties really exposes their flaws, but I'm gonna save that for later. While fighting through some Prometheans, Osiris comes across the prowler that Blue Team came in on. After scanning the inside, they find the path that Blue Team went through, a mine that goes into the mountain. Sloan begrudgingly lets Osiris through, and this leads to some dick swinging between him and Law because he wants to be difficult. "I don't give a damn if he isn't likely to be in the mines, just let us through so we can look for him, damn it." For those of you who haven't played Halo 5, yes, there is a reason for him being this damn difficult. It'll come up later in the mission. Once you get access to the mines after clearing out more Prometheans, Buck makes the correct and really smart observation that there was no sign of Blue Team engaged in combat through this area, and saying that the Prometheans most likely never engaged Blue Team. With that observation, that brings up a question. Of what could Blue Team have been doing when they got here? Did they sneak in? Or were they let in? Once again, Buck is putting his experience to work, and with good powers of deduction, rightfully calls out what is going on. "Not bad, Halo 5. You did something good with giving us information when we need it for once. Keep it up, please." As they go into the mines and fight more Prometheans, they see that Meridian has Forerunner architecture, showing us how everything around Meridian is connecting to the main story. There's even some constructors floating around, too. Foreshadowing? Osiris discusses how there was no record of Forerunner artifacts on Meridian, and Bell says that since the Requiem incident, there have been some Forerunner attacks on human worlds, but none as bad as this. If you put two and two together, you've already figured out this game's plot. Congratulations. In the fifth mission of 15. But that'll be going a little too far ahead to reveal that now, if you don't know. For now, though, let's just get to where we're actually getting with Osiris discussing things with each other. Once again, it's still not got that sense of urgency when they're talking to each other about this stuff. It doesn't have that sense of urgency that you need in a situation like this that really sets the stakes. No real emotions really put into the dialogue when Vale says this stuff. I sense more poor directing from the game, and it's, once again, really disappointing. Osiris then boards an elevator that takes them deeper into the Forerunner structure. Sloan tells them he's losing their signal as they go down, as his voice is drowned out by static. Buck responds jubilantly to this news, and Vale wonders why Sloan never bothered to report a find this big, as the Forerunner structure is massive. And it is big. And yeah, it's a big find, but he's also very anti-UNSC. Of course he'd hold off on revealing something this big until he could get a good price for it. I mean, he's a businessman. He's using some good old Ferengi tactics, it seems. Very interesting for him. Then Tanaka decides to be of some use again, theorizing that Sloan knew Blue Team was already here and let them through. For some reason. Now, while I credited Buck with his observation, because not only was it the right assumption, there was no evidence of Blue Team fighting either, so it really helped his point, Tanaka, though, while right, pulls it out of her ass. Now, I know Sloan isn't the happiest camper and doesn't really want to help out, but he hasn't really done anything much to stall Osiris, so I don't know what she was really getting at here with it. But I will be fair, though, she and Osiris don't really treat that as a certainty, so it's a lot better than everybody just taking that at face value. Locke even says they'll get him to talk after they get through investigating. I don't trust the guy either, but good on him for staying vigilant. But yeah, what the hell, Tanaka? Don't pull shit out of your ass. As the elevator stops and Osiris goes through the next door, they come across a weird room with a voice calling to them. She calls the guardians to serve her. Osiris, then fearing they may be ambushed, tries to get to the door at the far end of the room, only for it to close as they get close. The voice then says that they aren't welcome here in the guardian's shelter. Then we are revealed to a new character, a new Forerunner character, the Warden Eternal, a towering mass of metal and orange light, the first fully mechanical Forerunner enemy we've fought in a Halo game since Halo 3's Sentinels, and he has a voice as well, and with it, a conscious being. Oh, this looks interesting, a decent reveal for the boss. Yes, the Warden is a boss.
He stands in service to Cortana, which basically all but reveals that Cortana is the one directly involved with the colony disappearances, because they happen to be on worlds such as this one, for the Guardians. And after explaining that they are not approved for patches, but for passage, like the galaxy's most badass train conductor and pulling out a sword, he attacks Osiris. Now, what would seem to be like an interesting fight on paper is over very quickly if either you learn this game's quirks fast enough during the first playthrough, or you've already played this more than a few times. Warden is actually a pretty easy boss. All you really gotta do is just spam spike grenades or shotgun his back until his body explodes, or whatever the fuck his body does when it dies. Kinda disappointing. Sure hope they don't copy and paste them like DNF does with this bosses, and do really much of nothing to spice up the encounters with them other than putting a bunch of enemies around him. Oh, how I only hope. Once you're done wrecking him, Osiris puts the pieces together that Cortana wants the chief, and that they need to double time it to find him. We are then revealed to a giant space holding the namesake of this game, the Guardian, and it's one big son of a gun. And I like how it's revealed here, nothing overly dramatic or anything like that, it's just a part of the environment. But then something stupid happens. Buck wonders if what we're seeing is indeed the Guardian and openly asks that, for Tanaka to respond, "Can't get much by Buck." Like the game was trying to take a mark out of his intelligence or something like that. Huh? For one, it's obviously the Guardian. It's obviously the Guardian. What else in this fucking place could be the Guardian? And two, if the implication from Tanaka here is that Buck isn't all that smart, which further plays into the more comedic relief angle that they try to give him for this game, it's really fucking stupid. Buck isn't a stereotypical dumb soldier guy. And that's the same thing with his counterpart that he's based on, Malcolm Reynolds from Firefly. He's a troubled soldier who always knows the stakes of each situation he's in, but goes into the fray anyway. Yeah, he's got moments where he acts like a soldier would, and occasionally being goofy. That's not his character. Buck's also been at war for 25 years of his life. That's longer than what I presume you've been alive for, Tanaka. What's with that snark? It really feels disrespectful to Buck's character. Now, for the love of God, let's just get to where they find out where Blue Team is. So there's a teleportation grid on the platform under the Guardian that takes you up to the top of it. Only it's like a Mario grid and not something like the foreigners have that would just take you up to it immediately. They find it just as Blue Team are up a few panels from them, so a chase begins. Osiris chases Chief and Blue Team up the teleporters, but Locke reaches the teleporter just as it descends, making him the only one that can get to Blue Team's position. And I'm just gonna let the rest of the scene play out here because, as you can see, an even more pivotal moment deserves to be seen, not described.
Blue Team! Stay where you are. One-one-seven, stand down. Sir, you are absent without leave. This is your one chance to come home peacefully. Blue Team, stand down.
I have a job to do.
Cortana's our concern now, sir.
Like hell she is.
Yeah, what the hell were they thinking with this scene? Instead of having Osiris and Blue Team face off against each other to see what is the superior Spartan class, which the Spartan 2s are, obviously,
Blue Team just casually walks into the Guardian teleporter as Chief and Locke have a slow-as-fuck fight scene that would fit well in a sumo wrestling match. Not only that, the rest of Blue Team and Osiris are effectively sidelined for it all. The only people who are doing anything are Chief and Locke, and their fight is slow, awkward as hell, and without once again a sense of urgency. Everything here is just off. For one thing, only getting to see things from Osiris' perspective really limits what you can do to really tell and make the story feel expansive. I would have loved to have scenes of Chief and Blue Team discussing things about Cortana as they explore the shelter in Meridian. You open up about his experiences with her and how they are trying to help him console with her loss and the fact that she could still be alive, and that she is alive. In fact, you could have cut the Osiris' gun down mission and do that for Blue Team instead, as it reveals more about the story and Cortana's influence with the Forerunner architecture. We even get some dialogue from Blue Team expressing shock and concern. And then we switch to Osiris as they get closer to them, Blue Team full well expecting them and preparing to fight. As they meet, Locke tries to take in Chief, but Blue Team rushes to his defense and starts a massive fight between the Spartans 4s and the Spartan 2s, which is something a lot of people, I think, were really wanting to see from this game. That's something really good the game could have done here, so much could have done in just a few minutes, but instead they didn't, and rushed the story along again. Oh, come on, Brian Reed. This was your chance. This was your fucking chance to get more people interested in the story and make your game story not be hilariously mediocre, but you blew it. You fucking blew it! As Chief boards the Guardian, Osiris gets to Locke and removes the restraint on him, with the Guardian waking up a few seconds later, which, after watching this footage, Osiris could have easily boarded. They have like a few solid seconds in between taking the armor lock thing off of Locke and the Guardian waking up. They easily could have at least tried to jump for it. If it showed them jumping as the Guardian was waking up, and then the teleport disappearing, this wouldn't be that much of an issue. But they're just reacting to everything so slowly. Everything, they're reacting to everything in this cutscene really slowly, despite the fact, you know, Spartans are supposed to be super fucking fast. Once again, why is everything so slow? This is not how people in Call of Duty, but this is not... We're not trying to show how people in Call of Duty would react. We're trying to show how people, especially people physically augmented, would react to this type of stuff, which is supposed to be a lot different. Seems like everything in this game is just slow. So the teleporters all around the Guardian start falling into the molten lava below, so with time running out, Osiris then uses the teleporters that Blue Team got in on to get out of the shelter. Buck lagged behind a bit and was almost killed, but was saved in the nick of time by Locke before the teleporter falls into the lava. Once again, feeding into comedic relief, oh, he didn't make it in time. And then he got saved. Oh, wow. And then the next mission begins as soon as the cutscene ends. Yes, I made a mistake. I thought it was going to be the next three missions. It was actually four straight missions of not playing as the Chief. Four. Not even Halo 2 took you out of the driver's seat as the Chief for that long. It was always two in a row, not four. The fuck. Yeah, so instead of this last bit of Meridian being all in one level, which would have made it a lot longer than what it was, this will now be the fourth level in a row to take place on Meridian. A quarter of this game is spent on bumblefuck nowhere for the sake of the plot, and not for anything really meaningful. Nothing of any real use comes to the player in terms of information and good gameplay, and the fact that a quarter of this fucking campaign is spent here is bullshit. You could easily cut about half of these missions out and almost nothing would change. So much for the longest Halo campaign ever. As Locke exits the teleporter, they arrive on the surface to see that Sloan is calling out evac orders, as not only are the Prometheans attacking again, but the Guardian is also rising up out of the ground, where we can barely see it. You see like a couple of pieces and that's it, in the environment. Unless you're really paying attention, I guess, but I didn't see it. Vale is like, oh my god, he knows, trying to say that Sloan knew the whole time about the Guardian and Cortana, but I've always had a problem with this bit. First off, it isn't as if when we get back to the surface there was a moment of calm before we get attacked by Prometheans, so you're like, why the hell is he asking for evac orders? Why the hell is he doing that? They've obviously been attacking for quite a bit while you've been down in the caves. Secondly, just because he was calling for evac doesn't mean he intrinsically knew about what was gonna happen. So once again, this is pulling shit out of your ass. The attack could have been bad enough to warrant evacuation anyway. And thirdly, Holy shit, Vale, the fucking Guardian is rising up out of the ground near your position. I think you have bigger fish to fry right now instead of speculating. Just discuss that you need to evacuate, like you're doing right now, and after that, and since we have confirmation that the Guardians are the things calling the colony disappearances, we need to GTFO. So, come on. The next little bit of this mission is us going through familiar ground, you know, like you would in a Halo campaign, killing Prometheans and saving as many civilians as you can on the way to the space elevator. The compact is a lot more frantic, and the music, arguably, being more dramatic helps make the tension go up throughout the mission. Really helps make this mission more enjoyable from a gameplay perspective. But once again, since the story is taking a no-dive, it really doesn't make me feel like giving a fuck about anything. Too bad my good guy video game persona took over and I kept going to try to save as many people as I can. We eventually reach the space elevator after killing a ton of Prometheans, and Sloan thanks us for his help, for our help, his people once again, only for Vale to immediately jump on him and ask him about what Cortana told him about the Guardian, and for Sloan to not even try to hide that he was lying to them. Not that this is all extremely surprising if you figured it out beforehand or you just had an inkling of suspicion, but for her to just suddenly get on his ass like that is still very jarring to me. And the way Sloan doesn't even try to fight the accusation is also off. At least try to hide it. With all the information and dialogue we've gotten thus far, it was still plausible to think you didn't even know about any of this shit. Or at least you didn't know about the Guardian or Cortana Blue Team, just about the Forerunner architecture. That's all you really had to know. But whatever. Just don't even fight the accusation and spell out Cortana's plan to everybody. Sloan says that Cortana gave him enough of his warning to let his people survive, which means that a lot of this bloodshed could have still been avoided anyway. None of your people had to die. I know it would have probably been really suspicious to try to evacuate before any attack, and the attackers probably would have gotten people to evacuate anyway so you could have acceptable losses, but for fuck's sake, man, you could have easily gotten everybody off the planet. And if not everybody wanted to leave, make them leave anyway. You're the fucking administrator, aren't you? He then says this change is coming for both humans and created. Huh? What's this created? Is that what we're calling AIs now? Is this some type of random thing we're calling the race of machines that are sentient now? Created? I mean, yeah, they are technically creations because they are made by human hands. But AI aren't some second class of citizens. They're actually an integral part of the human experience in this universe. To try and use this kind of language to imply humans considering AIs as disposables, nonsense. Where is this coming from? They aren't even treated as machines by people in the books, and even dumb AI like Deja were treated as people by Halsey. And not only that, we have the Chief and Cortana's relationship in the entirety of this entire series. That depuncts that kind of point. Not that there wouldn't be people that would treat the AI as disposable, sure, there's probably a Blue Schematics-like character that would want to find a way to make AI bodies do hazardous jobs that humans can't do. But this isn't Star Trek, where they have a code that deals with life forms such as this and a moral descriptor. But AI, seriously, they're about as human as humans. It's part of why the Chief Cortana dynamic is so interesting in the first place. Considering AI is an integral part of winning the war in the first place, you know, having an AI in a fully armed warship really could tip the scales in humanity's favor. And, you know, Cortana, how AI are given the non-bender treatment from The Legend of Korra is really infuriating all of a sudden. Like, this feels exactly like that benderism stuff from Korra Season 1, but just like with Korra Season 1, there's not enough time, or they don't even really bother to make the reasons for that schism clear for us to see in the first place. I'll go in more detail on that one, though, later. Okay, so Sloan then tells his people that he cared so much for sayonara, and pieces the fuck out, leaving the remaining people on the space elevator and the colony to basically fend for themselves against the Prometheans, and I guess transferring himself to the Guardian. Don't know how that would work unless he was already there, but okay. The rest of the mission is just Osiris and the remaining human survivors on the elevator that will all die anyway. They're not going to live. There's no way with the context that we have for this mission that they're all going to live. And then Osiris reacting to Sloan just abandoning his people, and some really generic dialogue, oh, humanity's resilient, blah, blah, blah. And then they get to the top of the elevator as the Guardian starts blasting, it's getting ready to enter slip space, just like it did in ODST and Halo 2. And then just in the nick of time, they reach the Pelican, they head on standby, and despite the Pelican getting hit by multiple EMP waves, they get it start back up and flee as we see the Guardian disappear without any damage done to the colony visually in the scene fading to black again. Excuse me, what? Brian Reed, did you even play Halo 2 or ODST? How does he not know what a slipspace rupture in atmosphere does to a planet's surface? Did you not bother to play those two games? This is basic fucking knowledge. What are you, Alex Kurtzman now? You're not even bothering to watch stuff from a franchise that you're working on? This is just so fucking incompetent and fucking... Civvy, I apologize for doing this, but it's fucking raw! It is fucking... Fuck's sake, how can one be so dumb as to even let a sequence like that exist? Considering we've been hearing so much about the devastation from the other colonies, you'd think the audience would really want to see exactly what was getting people killed. Like, just what the fuck, man? This is just another peak way this game manages to kill any type of mystery it was trying to develop. And we're still not even halfway through the game yet, we still got another mission to get through. So before we get back to the Chief, let's discuss the AI-human conflict in this game that is trying to develop in the most contrived way imaginable again before I blow a gasket. So again, thanks to that scene earlier with Roland on raging on how it seems like everybody was against Cortana for no real reason, and seemed to stem from the fact that, at least to him, she survived far longer than she should have in Rampancy, which they did not want. This is the only other time in Halo's history, other than Captain Del Rio trying to retire Cortana if she freaks out on the Infinity in Halo 4, that we've gotten any kind of indication that anyone in the series, at least in the games, doesn't really like AIs and thinks of them as nothing more than hardware. And with all that we've gotten from the lore and the games themselves, AI are most certainly valued by UNSC and its personnel as much more than machines. I compared this to Book 1 of Korra for a simple reason. The Benderism doesn't really make sense in context. Despite the world of Avatar being a universe where Benders previously were the dominant class thanks to having that natural ability, and the world was built in a way that reflected that, Korra, unlike the Last Airbender, the world was much more technologically advanced, a lot closer to the 1920s American free-spirited kind of way of living than pre-industrial Asia. But that means more ways for non-Benders to make things to cater to themselves and make their lives easier, and even ways to defend themselves more effectively from Benders like the shot clubs. Though it's still also without guns, which is a big gripe I have. And you even have non-Benders in more positions of power in Republic City, from being rich and powerful to even having political power in later books. My point is that the Benderism angle is really contrived, since not only is the world more catering to them than the Benders now, but also non-Benders were never discriminated against in OG Avatar either, at least as far as we could see from the other three nations other than the Fire Nation. Even then, the only ones they really didn't like were the people who lived in the Earth Kingdom colonies. They were expected to fight in their land same as regular Benders, and everyone lived together that way. Instead of trying to build a conflict more organically, they decided to try to do an X-Men type of story, only with Xavier as the villain and not Magneto, trying to take away people's power in order to make everyone equal instead of just accepting the mutations, and that more people would become mutant as time went on. It makes the reason for the equalists in the show doing what they're doing really moot, especially considering the other thing at the end of the season that made it all even worse. The same contrivance lands with the AI stuff. The AI haven't really been treated horrifically as far as we know of by the UNSC, and while they are made for specific purposes and thanks for the war effort they're all over the place, I'd say being a dumb AI is living the high life. Dumb AI don't have the complex matrices of smart AI, meaning they won't die from rampancy. They technically could live forever if handled correctly by human counterparts, as Deja was in service from the beginning of the Spartan 2 program till the attack on Reach and the fall of Reach, and even then, I don't even actually know if she's dead yet. Smart AI are a different story though, as with the rampancy aspect, you could definitely write a story about an AI that isn't Cortana trying to find a way to cure their rampancy or even trying a way to make it to where smart AIs can't die, and how that conflicts with, you know, protocol of the UNSC. You could do something like that. Smart AIs are more volatile, but that's the risk in making one, since they are made from human DNA, and they're basically clones. Cortana herself is actually a clone of Dr. Halsey, a representation of her more younger, more free-spirited self, before running the Spartan 2 program made her the more callous figure she became in later years. It's part of the reason why her figure has no clothing, because that is the form she chose for herself. Cortana can still pick and choose what she wants to do. That's part of the thing of being an AI. But not only that, she mixes that with the fact that she has aspects of her character from Halsey, owed in fact to the fact that Halsey created her with her own DNA. So, Cortana and Halsey still do greatly care for the people they work with, and they both have an immense caring for John specifically. And as Cortana's crampancy worsened in Halo 4, we saw that she was losing more and more control of her emotions, leading to some not great moments towards the later half of the campaign with her freaking out. But even then, Askie wasn't being a dick to Cortana. Neither Palmer or anyone else that was human. It was just Del Rio. Even in her state, she was still of great use, so working with the smart AI in the late stages of Ramsey is a double-edged sword. But people still treated Cortana as a person, especially the Chief. But my point still stands. We still don't have that much of a basis for AI discrimination. This is a thing more in line with Star Trek, that Star Trek could actually do and has done more effectively, since it deals most of the time with much more complex moral issues than Halo. For example, the episode Measure of a Man from Season 2 of The Next Generation actually deals with a guy named Bruce Maddox trying to disassemble Data in order to make more of him, with the express purpose of them running entire starships and even doing more hazardous work that regular humans can't do. Low-cost labor that can be treated as expendable. Maddox clearly only thinks of Data as a machine and only refers to him as it. Only Data doesn't want that, as he is fearful that Maddox may harm him. But faced with no choice, Picard then defends him in a tribunal in order to prove that Data is indeed, despite being an android, a life form that is worthy of all the rights and protections of a Federation citizen and member of Starfleet. Because Data is a unique life form. The Soong androids are indeed life forms. It's a really good episode that really delves into the morality of AI research and what constitutes a life. And even at the end of the episode, Maddox calls Data him. And not it, as he had throughout the rest of the episode, showing that even he could have his mind changed. Remember when Star Trek was good? I remember. Anyway, if we were to get to more insight for this kind of issue in Halo, it needed to be built up a lot more than literally one cutscene of Roland freaking out and a couple small inklings in the missions with Sloan in order to really build up the AI discrimination angle. Not that you couldn't do this well, but it's not being done well in this game. So anyway, let's move on to the next Chief mission. Ah, shit.